Kind of. Yeah, but you could turn around. Yeah, there's that little there where
it's on.
So tonight's the Yom HaZikaron. We should mention before we start the yard site of the Rebbe's the yard site of the Rebbe's wife, Chayim Mushke. There is, and that was in 1988, so it's in 19, let's say, 92, 91. So every year on her yard site, the day that she passed away, it would parade through, past the Rebbe would stand at his prayer stand, and they parade through hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of Jewish women and girls. Since the year of 1988, they were named after her. They gave him a lot of power and a lot of energy, because they were very close. Mm-hmm. This was the daughter of the previous Rebbe, Rebbe number 6, and she married Rebbe number 7. So her father and her husband and her grandfather were all Rebbe's. So she was somebody very, obviously very special. But at the same time, she was as prestigious as she was, as accomplished, with her own office in the New York Public Library in Manhattan, etc. No one knew about her. She didn't appear in public. She was Rebbe's wife, you can imagine. Tens of thousands of adoring disciples of Hasidim were her husband's fans, and she didn't get involved, she didn't. But they had, obviously, found out later, after she passed away, very powerful connection. And so that was very something special also. So just to mention her name, Chaim Mushke, grandchildren and children, etc. At this point, there's thousands of Chaim Mushkes, hoping that a little spark of her soul was reincarnated in them.
In the school, Chaim Mushke.
Wow.
And that's right, there's a school called Chaim Mushke, whole school.
Is that what it means?
Sorry?
If you share someone's name, does it mean that you have a spark of that soul?
Usually, if you name somebody after a tzaddik, a tzaddika, a holy woman, a holy man, etc., that means you're inviting a spark of their soul, because each soul has 600,000 sparks, so there's a lot to go around. You're not already going to run out of reincarnations. It doesn't work like that, and it's not like jelly beans and houses and alimonies. We're not talking about that each thing is universal, cosmic, and special. Each spark of soul, even though there's 600,000
sparks. The name Dina, for example, she.
Well, we're not going to go through private names now. give me a call, email me. We'll do a special kosher astrology. You're only $1,000 for 3 minutes.
That stuff is real.
Yeah.
It is.
So the idea. is that this Torah class of tonight is dedicated to the elevation of the soul of Chaim Mushke Bat Yosef Yitzchok, because she was the daughter of the Rebbe number 6. So that's the way you give an official name. That's the soul name. The soul name means it's the pipeline of blessing. Jewish men get their soul name at the bris, usually 8 days after they're born, at the circumcision. Jewish women, especially from Iran, really don't get any name at all. They don't get Jewish names. So they're nameless souls. That's not a value judgment. I'm saying that if you have no pipeline of blessing, so you can have lots of blessings right here. What's the expression in Kabbalah when you give someone a blessing? It should be lemata mi'asarat fachim. Anybody know what that means? That's Hebrew.
It doesn't go.
That doesn't. Lemata. What's mata?
Down.
Lemata me'asara.
From 10.
Less than 10. What's a tefach? Anybody know what that is?
Hand.
That's right. Fist. Ten tefachim means our world. In other words, less than 10 tefachim down. Here, where we occupy this world. So that's the name and the blessing, the pipeline. If you don't have a name, you don't have a pipeline. The blessing can be stuck. Right? I don't know what his name is, or whatever, but he could be, he's George, I'm here, l'chaim. So I thought that, you know, I met this fellow, very talented young fellow, when he was 15. Now he's already 20 years a rabbi in Toronto. So I ask you, after 20 years in the ministry, being a rabbi in an Orthodox synagogue in Toronto, give me in one sentence, in one word, what are you doing there as a rabbi? So he's a very enthusiastic 15-year-old. And he said to me, now he's, I don't know, 40 years old, he said to me, I'm dealing in tragedy. First of all, this life cycle. Second of all, who comes to the rabbi? People need some pastoral counseling. For psychological counseling, it's $150 a pop for the 15-minute hour, but rabbis are double sessions for nothing. And sometimes they seem to be more caring because they look at Jewish people as family, even if they don't know them, especially if they're into Kabbalah and mysticism that says we are all one soul. Which finger do you not like?
Jews
are family. Sorry?
Jews and non-Jews.
No, non-Jews are not part of the family. Jews are defined as from the seed of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. The rest are goyim. That doesn't mean there's no good goyim. That doesn't mean there's no bad Jews. But Avat Yisrael is for Israel. There's lots of, you know, everybody knows the Jews build hospitals for, you know, was it the Jewelstein Eye Hospital, the Hospital UCLA Medical Center. That's Jewish people.
Cedars.
We took Jewish Cedars, yeah. A lot of Jewish, but it's not so much the other way around. But anyway, let's not get into, Jewish souls come from the seed of the three patriarchs and the four matriarchs. That's the definition of a Jew. Or, I mean, hopefully it's not because somebody's grandmother is embarrassed with her coffee clutch and it's that cheap, but thousands of years of Jewish blood being sacrificed. So because so-and-so is stripping so-and-so, you gotta eat it and make it, you know, some making a bunch of conversion. But that's personal, not Kabbalic. Maybe it is. But tonight's topic is the secrets of love according to the secrets of Kabbalah. So, since, what did he mean by tragedy? Same thing, I've been 44 years a rabbi in Los Angeles, and tragedy used to come once, twice a month, and today three times a day. Talking about children, I'm looking for number three, number four. Number four is we do on a Sunday afternoon, back to back. Because by that time you're not getting the caterer and the band, etc. However, if it's such a miserable failure, and the statistics are up to, do you know what the statistics are in divorce? 10 years ago was 52%, that's a hint. What is it? 62%. That means, my dearest friends, that love is a threatened institution. That means 2 out of 3 couples are going to get divorced if it's the first marriage in 6.9 years, if it's the second marriage in 5.4 years. Why do second marriages last less time than first marriages? Because anyone who ever got divorced, even if their parents were divorced, never imagined that it would happen to them. When it does, I'm okay, second marriage, been there, done that, bye. I mean, 4.5 years, I mean, you know, went through this, I'm not going to do this again. It's okay. So, you know, Gallup poll is less than 500 people. My computer spread tells me I know 2,500 couples, some of them married once, twice, thrice, and 4,000 singles, that's the other 9,000 people, that's today. What about 10 years ago, 20 years ago, 30 years ago? I already did second generation marriages. You know what I'm talking about? Married a couple, they had a child, they married a guy. I mean, so I reside in the living laboratory of, you know, human psychology, plus we have 5 daughters and 7 sons, so I always resided in the living laboratory of child psychology, watched them grow up, and, you know, that sort of thing. And after a while, you get what the Kabbalah says, I think I told you that last time, that the most important novum, almost, new information that Kabbalah has to offer beyond the 32 different schools of human psychology is that there are 2 souls, not one. The natural soul and the holy soul. Natural is not evil, it's what comes naturally. And the holy soul means, the best judge of the good news here in terms of feeling secure and confident about which path to take is, who would be the best judge of human nature? Well, we know at age 40 is the age of understanding. So if you're not 40, it could be you haven't reached Ben Arba'im Libina. As a matter of fact, the 63 volumes of the Talmud, is the most important book of the Bible right after the Bible itself. And there is a version of Talmud called Pirkei Avot, one volume. And there it says the age when you acquire stuff. There's early childhood development, 5 years old. Then there's the age of 40, which is Ben Arba'im Libina. What's Bina mean?
Kokman.
Sorry, Bina means what?
A wise Bina, no?
Nope.
Understanding.
Understanding.
The age of understanding. After 10 years of being in the age of understanding, what happens to you physiologically at that point in your life? Ben Chamishim Le? 50 years old, then? What is a bunch of Hebrew school dropouts here? What? Nobody knows anything about
senility?
Ben Chamishim Le? 50, it's. We're up to 50, dude. Where's 50? Where's 50? 50 years, do I hear 6? No. Ben Chamishim Le Eitza. What's Eitza mean? You're giving advice to somebody else? Why would you know more than they? Even if you went to school. Ben Chamishim Le Eitza, if you have 10 years of understanding at age 40, what's the 40 thing? The Jews got the Ten Commandments and they went on permanent retreat for 40 years. Till they were allowed to enter the Holy Land. Process. What does the Gemara say from there? The Gemara is in Aramaic. Like koim inish adaiti de rabbi ad arboin shnin. A person doesn't understand what his rabbi said until 40 years later of reviewing it and trying to understand it. Moses comes down from Mount Sinai with the Ten Commandments that everybody heard, the two tablets, and for 40 years they studied it. Moses was the teacher, and then when he went to the Promised Land, had already 40 years of, because of 620 letters in the Ten Commandments. How many commandments are there in the Bible, in the 24 books, in the 5 books of Moses, let's say? Commandments come from the 5 books of Moses.
613,
correct, Phyllis. 613 commandments. How many commandments did the rabbis say, we want you to do rabbinical commandments?
You mean positive ones?
Well, not that positive or negative. I mean, Hanukkah is a rabbinical.
Seven.
Lighting the candles is a rabbinical, that's one. Right? Post-biblical holidays. Purim. Hear the Megillah, that's another one.
Lighting candles.
Lighting Shabbat candles. Anyway, there's seven. Seven and 613 makes 620, as the Kabbalists would say, 620 pillars of light. Pillars rooted in the earth, with their top of them in heaven, of light, meaning like a light show, kind of, but bringing the light of wisdom of the divine from the highest to the lowest. Four worlds, which world is ours? Number four. How low can you go? Rock bottom. There's no world that is more dense than rock bottom. It doesn't get any more. It's called at Olam HaTachton, the lowest world, number four. On Passover, when you drink the four cups of wine, that's for ascending water. We live in the world of, it's called, what is this world called? Our world, in Kabbalah. Sorry?
Olam HaZeh,
that's true. But in terms of the four worlds, they each have different names. It's called Abiyah, is an abbreviation, an acronym. You know, this IBM, I've been misled, you know all those. So this Abiyas Atzilut Briya Yitzira Asiya, in descending order. Right after the Ein Sof, after God, you can't go from Ein Sof to concrete. That's a big jump. You need four worlds, four stages of development, four levels of consciousness. Each world has a different creature on it. This is the only world that has us human creatures on it. But this world, our world, the most physical, material world, with the only world that has the possibility for a person to be an atheist. the other three worlds is no possibility, because you live in a world of godliness. You can't miss it. Those angels in those worlds are called fish. Why? Where are the humans? And they're called fish. Because fish don't commit suicide. Fish don't get depressed. Fish know where they live from. Don't jump out of their life source. Fish are constantly conscious. They have an awareness of where they're being animated from the water. So those kind of creatures of those three worlds number, let's see, these in water, 1, 2, and 3, are called fish. Here, in our world, so anything, it's a very dense, thick, more material, physical. Spirituality is a minority, not a majority. Our world is counter-conducive to spirituality. You have to realize you have two strikes against you. Look around. You have friends, you have relatives that you even might enjoy an evening like this. They're not here, you're here. It's a minority, not a majority in this world, in the fourth world, our world, or what we occupy. To be conscious of something, of another reality that's not, can't be really easily seen, takes some work, some effort, some entertainment. I mean, after you get to be married, it's already, you get a clop here and a clop there. I mean, little medical situation that, you know, wake up calls. So thank you very much. I'm very woke up now and I'm having a time. But, so the idea of, there's certain experiences, but anyway, if, again, back to the original problem, if there's such a problem with, there's only one out of three makes it, so then if the best judge of human nature should be the one that created it. Instead of, you know, the Freudian, the Jungian, and other different schools of thought, some in behavioral science, some of them opposing each other, the way I was thinking is, what about going to the person who created human nature and find out if he wrote his magnum opus, divine wisdom, like we said last week, in the first word of the Ten Commandments. Anochi, I am the Lord thy God. It's a four-letter word for I. Aleph Nun Chof Yud, which stands for such a beautiful acronym. Ana Nafshi Ketavit Yehavit. Every artist says that. And God being the artist of the capital, he said it too. I am the Lord thy God. Anochi is an acronym standing for I wrote my soul into it. That's what God says about the book he wrote. He didn't neglect human nature between X and Y chromosomes. Maybe there's some smarts in there. Not only is it thousands of years old, for men, many millennia where people didn't have the problem, didn't separate, but. So he said, not even a recap, but you have to, here we're talking about the topic tonight is the second sentence of Shema. And thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy hearts and all thy soul and all thy might. Simply put, how much time you got? I mean, we could stay here for 3 days with that second sentence. And it's actually in the imperative. Someone pointed that out to me when I was saying it a lot already. You know, it's 106:13 in the Bible. To say it twice a day, when thou liest down, when thou riest up. That's it for men and women. To say the Shema, that's the first thing they teach you as a kid. Mm-hmm. Shema Yisrael. And the last thing you're supposed to say when you leave the world, Shema Yisrael. The most important one-liner in the Jewish religion is the Shema. Six words. Three of the six is God. Not too much meat on that verse, huh? I mean, this is the most important sentence, and people who are committed to saying it every morning and every night, twice a day, like it says. That's one of the 650 commandments. That sentence should be spoiled up. We did that last week, or 2 weeks ago, rather. And the second sentence is also powerful. That it's in the imperative. Thou shalt love v'ahavta. It's not an optional suggestion. It's one of the 613. It's a command in the Bible. And I was thinking, wait a minute. Let's think I was commanded me in there to love purple. I don't like purple. or to love God. I mean, I'd like to say I do, let's say I don't feel it right now. You know, I mean, things change, time change. Today, tomorrow, this hour, next hour, good news, bad news. And right now I'm not feeling, I should say those words, and that's the, if you say the words, is it you, would you accomplish anything? Or do you have to feel it when you say it? And if I say it and I don't feel it, have I fulfilled that commandment in the Bible?
No.
Oh, we got like every year, two Jews and
no
fear and three advance.
No.
What does it say? What does God say? What does the Bible say? What does it say in the good book? What does it say in the code of Jewish law? What does Jewish wisdom say? I think before we offer an opinion, we should get some backup, some background, and then jump to where your heart tells you or not. The first sentence is a commandment too. So what is the Shema a commandment? It's got to be a commandment. It's the most important sentence in the Bible. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Is that a commandment, yes or no?
Yes.
Yes,
what's the commandment?
You shall not worship any other God.
That's the second. Thou shalt have no other God before me, is that you should not worship the God. That's in the Ten Commandments in Deuteronomy. This is in Exodus, and there it says in Exodus, in Deuteronomy, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You say it is one of the 248 thou shalt commandments?
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like a thou shalt, doesn't it?
No.
It sounds like a thou shalt not? What's the thou shalt not about it? Is it a thou shalt not or thou shalt? There's 248 thou shalts and 365 thou shalt nots. That's the 613. Is it a thou shalt or thou shalt not? Are we open for
neither.
Well, you got two choices.
Neither.
Yo?
Shall.
Neither. That's interesting.
It's just a statement. It's a statement of fact.
Nice, very nice. So it's not a commandment.
It is.
It's up to you.
What you're saying is very profound, and there's a whole shmooze, and we'll talk on that, but can't get to all of it. But some of it I want to point out, just to focus on what you said. There is those that said, there's a period of Jewish history called the codifiers, meaning from code of Jewish law. We have something called a code of Jewish law in our religion, like black letter law, how to, chapter, and then paragraphs, like how you fulfill the commandment of going to the mikveh? How you fulfill the commandment of putting on tefillah? How you fulfill? That's called the Code of Jewish Law. That's one volume codified out of 63 encyclopedic volumes of but there's no discussion. It's do this, don't do that. There's no philosophy, you know, theology. It's called the Code of Jewish Law in English. What's it called in Hebrew?
Shulchan Aruch.
Good. Shulchan Aruch. Shulchan is the Hebrew word meaning what?
Table.
What's Aruch mean?
Long.
Right.
That's with an aleph. So the Shulchan Aruch is with an aleph, it's long. But it's with an ayin. Not aleph. The set table. How to Jew in many difficult lessons. The table's all set there. We got to pick up the book. You want to know how to do whatever? It's right there in the book. That codifiers made codes of Jewish law, but the most famous is the code of Jewish law, Shulchan Aruch, written by whom?
Rabbi Joseph Karo.
Yeah, we got a resident scholar in the back there. Rabbi Joseph Karo, the second most visited grave in one of the four holy cities of Israel called Tzfat is Rabbi Joseph Karo, the author of the code of Jewish law. He lived only 400 or 500 years ago, because he took it out, and he was the codifier.
Who was the first? You said the second.
The first was the second greatest Kabbalist that ever lived, the Holy Lion of Tzfat. What was his name?
Isaac the
Arizal. Arizal was, his full name was Rabbi Yitzchak Luria Ashkenazi. And he was called the Arizal, because Ari means lion, Holy Lion of Tzfat. Why they call him the Ari? Because even though he passed away very, very young, 38, Ari is three letters. He's the only one in Jewish history at that young age or ever, who got the title Eloki Rabbeinu Yitzchak, the godly Rabbi Isaac. Tell everybody in past lives in the Farhat, he was the second greatest Kabbalist ever lived. 12 volumes of Lurianic Kabbalah. And he moved to Sfat in the last year and a half of his life. For what reason? He lived in Egypt, and he was born in Jerusalem. His father died, a young poor widowed mother. So she sent him to his rich uncle in Alexandria. Any long story, but He went to Tzfat in the last year and a half of his life. Why did he go to Tzfat?
I think he thought it was more spiritual, closer to God.
Good, good, good. But yes, via a 20-minute bus ride, there were no buses. But today it's a 20-minute bus ride to a little place called Miron. Who's buried in Miron? The number one Kabbalist. No. What's the most important book of Kabbalah, period?
Zohar.
Who wrote it?
Rabbi Shimon.
Rashbi is buried in Miron, 2nd century. So the Arizal came along 16th century, the last year of his life to be, I don't know how long it took him with a donkey, but today it's a 20-minute bus ride, $3.50. People go, where are you going? I want to see Rabbi Shimon. Well, I'll visit Rabbi Shimon. Like he was there. I mean, he passed away in the 2nd century. But the fact is, the most visited grave of the year in the planet Earth, one day a year, is Lag BaOmer. It's called the Holiday of Mystical Joy. The day he died, he declared it from then on going to be a holiday because it was granted to him. First of all, every saint that dies is of the Jews. Why did he die? Because he had nothing left to do. He accomplished all his life's ambitions and it was fulfilled that day. So that's his biggest. Bye. I did everything I fantasized about doing spiritually, every long rung of the ladder I climbed. And now I'm going to heaven and I leave you this world. Even the Goyim complained when the Rashbi died, because it looks like nobody died when he was living there in Miron. Because now even there's a 30 bed and breakfast vegetarian restaurants, like half a block away from Miron, with a view of the Kinneret, of the Sea of Galilee. Very special vortex of energy. Anybody with half a heart feels it, I mean. That's just a gravesite of a man who died 2,000 years ago. So, you know, 500,000 people come once a year. It's a light warmer. Let's say 300,000 people, and it's a Jewish millionaire. So let's say 300,000 people come one day a year, like women, to the anniversary of the death of the greatest Kabbalist. The second mystic gets 3,000. From 300,000, so the Arizal's Yotzeit is the fifth of Leo, 3,000 people come. The third greatest Kabbalist is buried right underneath the Arizal. What's his name?
Ramak,
good. Very few people know that. And Moshe Kodavero. His Yotzeit is observed by 300 people. So you see there's a hierarchy. Hundreds of thousands of people come to the one who wrote. So anyway, back to the codifiers. So the first sentence by the, if you're talking to a codifier, some of the codifying laws, first sentence is the commandment to, depends how you look at it, the commandment to believe in God. But then people raise the question, wait a minute, God can't command a commandment to believe in God. Because if you believe that there is a God, then you don't need a commandment about it. If you don't believe that there is a God, that's not going to help if he's going to command you to believe in God. You don't believe in God. So it's a circular thinking. So that's what they threw it out. I mean, that's basically what I'm getting what you're saying. They modified it. What's the tweak? Listen to this. The first commandment is to believe in the unity of God. What does the Shema say? God is one. That idea to believe that God is one with everything, that's the commandment of the Shema. To believe in one God, not more than one God, is not a big problem, really. We have certain axioms, ein davar aser et atzmo, nothing may create itself. So where are we going to go? Big bang. What happened there? Who made the big, I mean, where did you get that stuff, you know? Whatever it is, sooner or later you're going to have to come to something that transcends the rational 2+4 kind of situation. With the unity of God, you have that problem, faith. It seems like there's no God here. It's just a table, it's made out of wood. It's not, here is, and I'm alive and I have the privilege, if I want to say that God does not exist, I exist. But I'm not sure about God, let's say. So, I mean, you can have that, the first commandment, in other words, in terms of hierarchy, the codifiers, maybe five of them are famous, they're called classics. To believe in the unity and the oneness of God. Yeah, so then it says in the very beginning, God creates man in Genesis. So God created man in God's image. What's the image of God in man? The soul. The soul has 10 soul powers. Just like God has 10 spheres, spherot, to the revelation, faculties of manifestation, communication. How's God, how do you communicate? Well, we are in the image of God. So we can observe us, and from us, something we could maybe even agree upon somewhat, we can understand God better. And then go back down to us and understand human, us people better. So every time you study Kabbalah, the original intention of studying Kabbalah was to understand God. Now I'm saying there's enough wealth of material here where we can understand each other. So what does it mean man's soul has 10 soul powers? They're subdivided into 2, 3, and 7. What's the 3 and the 7? The 3 are called the mothers. The 3 mothers and the 7 multiples. Because there's no pure emotion. There's multiples. Sometimes it's love and hate. That could be. Two sides of the same coin. Sometimes it's where the, and there's 3 intellect powers, cognitive powers, 3 steps of intellect that you use to ingest information, and 7 emotions. They're the mothers because they birth emotions. If you have enough understanding about a topic, then you can be moved emotionally. What does it mean when a person cries, according to the mystics? That means it's called motre mochin. It exceeded your brain power and came out through your eyes. You can't handle it intellectually, so you move to tears. What happens if it bypasses that stage of mothers? It's like, boom, comes out emotion. That's called either infatuation or an imagined, false, vain emotion. You could be making a mistake. That's not a real emotion. It doesn't have a reality to it. And how many times have I heard, because, you know, women are basically honest with only 2 kinds of people. They're gay male friends. And rabbis that won't even shake their hand. I have no agenda. You know, it's almost TMI, but I keep calm. It's okay. That's what I do. So that's a good thing. And so after a while, the two really don't understand each other. Even that, I find it fascinating after 3 marriages and talking to, you know, men and women, they still don't get it. Because neither understand each other, kind of. We used to have this thing, I told you, the Jewish Mental Health Association of Los Angeles, we used to meet in Cedar Sinai, we were here once a month, there for 3.5 years, once a month for like 4 hours maybe, dragged down, we'd make 15 guys, 5 rabbis and 15 shrinks, yogins. And throw out a 1-line statement and fight over it till we got it almost unanimous. So that was really exciting. And I said, I think only 70% of shrinks are effective. No, I said only 30% of psychologists are effective. I think the other 70% are either at best nothing or at worst detrimental. And they all disagreed with me. They said they think less than 10% are effective.
Wow.
That's probably about 15 shrinks there. We met for 3.5 years.
Rabbi.
Once a month, yeah.
Does that depend on the method or the understanding of perception of the therapist?
Well, the therapists answered that way. There was no patients there. It was all 15 psychologists and 5 rabbis who did a lot of pastoral counseling. I was one of the youngest people there. And Levi Meir wrote a lot of books. He was the chaplain in Cedar Sinai. Rabbi Dr. Levi Meir, he was a Jungian psychologist and a rabbi, and he gave a class in Bible at Beth Jacob after services, before the Kiddush, and people, you know, stayed for 45 minutes for his Jungian Chumash Bible thing. But then, getting back to the point over here is that Jung wrote 12 books, and in the last book, he wrote everything that I know to be true by my personal experience and understanding. Was already intuited a century earlier by a Hasidic rabbi named Dov Ber of Mezrich. This Dober Ms. Rich was the successor to one who founded Hasidism, Baal Shem Tov. So anyway, so this is the idea of the, so there's seven emotions. He said that the truly, but the of the seven emotions, two are primary, the other five are offshoots. So for me, that's already a lot of information, and very desirable information, because everybody, every human is created in the image of God, meaning you have a soul. So I'm interested, because it's like that, I told you about that in Marina Del Rey. I passed by Washington Boulevard, I'm driving, I saw a shop, and the shop just had three words on it, all about me. It looks like it was an ailery thing, you know? I got a pedicure, but I mean, it was, but I can't really bend down and do it. But meanwhile, it was, I thought I was, well, okay. It's kind of the state of the world we're in, the number four world. How low can you go? It's, altruism is not, so the second commandment we said is, the second sentence of the Shema is to love God, right? How can God commit an emotion? Even to believe in Him, whatever. How can God command us to experience an emotion?
Love.
Yeah, like love your neighbor as yourself. And that's a hard one, because it doesn't want us to love your neighbor. It wants to you to love them at what level?
Like yourself.
As much as why, excuse me? I don't think so. I mean, it's all about me, I thought we just said, okay? And I don't even know you. I don't even know if I want to know you. I mean, and you want, that's in the Bible, Leviticus 19:18, chapter 19, verse 18. Ve'ahavta l'reacha kamocha. Another love word in the Bible. So I'm getting excited. There's love words here in God's Bible.
Rabbi,
every Christian believes that this is the word of God. Yes.
Doesn't l'reacha mean your friend?
Yes, your fellow, whatever. So then, and the other love word is the, even the more famous one, the one that's supposed to be studied tonight. You should love the Lord your God with all your hearts and all your soul and all your might. So some people say, what's the commandment in that second sentence of the Shema? Second sentence of the most important prayer in the Jewish religion? Thou shalt love. Or how do you fulfill that commandment? Especially if there's a code of Jewish law that tells you how to fulfill the 613 biblical precepts. So what does it say about? And then, if we learn how to love God, maybe we can learn how to love another, or some of the prestigious spots in mysticism that tell you about love and how to love. Just want to show you a little bit. This is an encyclopedia of Hasidic mysticism. This is. So funny. The letter Aleph, not going through the whole 22 letters of the Hebrew alphabet, just from Aleph to Aleph He, like the first five letters in the Aleph letter. Like Aleph He would be Ahava, love. So what does it say in Kabbalah about love? Well, here's where it starts. I don't know if you can see this. This bold print says Ahava right here. And then, what I really wanted you to see is the little red underlines and green markings and highlighters. That's all mine, the whole thing.
You actually read it.
Yep, I read it. I read it and I wrote a little itty bitty comments on it. But this is where it came from, and this is how I did little sound bites of it. So the founder of the Hasidic movement was Rabbi Israel Bar Shem Tov. What he did is he created a new ism in Judaism. And he was criticized because he only lived like 300 years ago. But what was the ism of Hasidism that was founded in the 1700s? To John, I come lately. Our religion is 4,000 years old. This is a couple, 250 years old. But it's like big news. Everybody knows about the Hasidim. You see them and I see them, but what is they? Hasidim. And now every temple has a Hasidic service with the Rebbe singing the guitar, whatever they do. But the successor and founder, the one who Jung said he learned his behavioral science from, Dover of Mizrach, is called Hamagid HaGadol, the great preacher. The Baal Shem Tov traveled. He was his protege and his successor. He was a sickly man. He didn't travel. He stayed in Mizrach and he taught from there. He had 10 students. Baal Shem Tov traveled, had many students. He had 10 students, the Maggid of Mizrach. The youngest was the Alter Rebbe, the Baal HaTanya. An offshoot of general Hasidism to something called rational mysticism. He was a Litva, a Talmudic genius. When he was 13, his province, all the cities in his province, all the scholars heard his bar mitzvah speech that he made up, and so everybody said in that province, many cities of great scholars, they have nothing to teach him. He was a 13-year-old prodigy, and he founded basically the Chabad movement 7 generations ago. His name was Schneer. So everybody named Schneerson means they came from him. So what did the Maggid say? The Rebbe of the Rebbes of the 7 Rebbes of Chabad. He said, in order to fulfill the commandment to love God, you need to meditate. That's the way you do it. What do you meditate on? You meditate on the Gadlut Abore, Gadlut Ein Sof, on the greatness of God. So when I was a kid, I thought God was great. Allahu Akbar. Not quite that, right? But I thought great means like Superman, and he's swinging, you know, he can fly, and he's genius, very like 10 computers, 1,000 computers. You gargantuan, humongous, and very big. Very, very big. Then I have to get a little more mature in our understanding of what does it mean great. Meditate on the greatness of God, and that will arouse your love in you for God. So here already we hear something that Kabbalah says that we didn't know before. Especially if you are from the seed of the chosen people. Like it says in Exodus chapter 4, verse 22. In Exodus, every Christian believes this is the truth. It's a divine writ. My son, my firstborn, is Israel. We are all children of God, 6 billion people on planet Earth, but the firstborn child is the Jewish people. They're the ones that gave the pagans ethical monotheism. Instead of sacrificing to the Canaanite gods' children, human sacrifice, there's that pivotal point in history when everybody saw that Abraham is about to sacrifice his son Isaac, which is irrational. Because God said, you're going to have a people, and he's taking his only child at the age of 100 years old, and he's killing him. So our connection to God transcends human thinking, rational thinking. So what did the Maggid say? The Maggid say, meditate on the greatness of God, and you will arouse love for God in your heart. So I thought about, what about the practical value of that? Let's say you're somewhat estranged from your significant other. How can you restore that or get it back? I think there's practical value in meditating on past history when each person was more involved with the other than.
But how do we meditate? What is it exactly that we should meditate?
Well, that's what it's saying. In terms of the mysticism part, not the human interpersonal relationship, in terms of what it's originally meant for, there's 10 names of God, 7 that can't be erased, Shiva, Shemoshe, Nam, Nitzhakim, but all the Kabbalists exclusively and unanimously use only one name for God, and it isn't any one of those 10 names. What's the name that all Kabbalists use in all books of Kabbalah for God? What do you say?
Ein
Sof. That's the name out of all the names for God that Jewish mystics said is the closest to naming God. Ein Sof means the infinite, the limitless. That means a being that can keep track of 6 billion people's thoughts and even answer them at the same time. past, present, and future are a blip. 6,000 years of history are the blink of an eye, and everything in detail can be seen. That fathoms the human understanding because we don't have that. Bobby Fischer is great because he can play 100 in chess with 100 people. God is no end, endless, limitless. So here let's get into a little bit, some definitions of the favorite topic. Been a favorite topic for centuries. Love songs. Just love, poetry and stuff like that. Very popular topic. What does mysticism say about love? Some definitions. What's the first definition? It says about the ohev and ahuv. Ohev is the lover, ahuv is the beloved. One of the first signs about love is dvekut. What does that mean?
To be good.
Sorry? Dvekut, devek. It's a Hebrew word, it has a meaning.
Glue.
Sorry?
Glue.
Glue, that's so cute. Yeah, devek is modern Hebrew for glue. Sometimes a sign of being in love with someone is you want to be with them all the time. You want to be dvekut, you want to be like. And what does that mean when you're that close? Ideally, you can empathize rather than sympathize. Their pleasure is your pleasure. Their pain is your pain. After it's something bad, it's my best friend. It's my significant. Their pleasure, you can't, you got engaged, mother, so grow. I'm so happy for you. Okay. So what would be the reasons for loving? Or three kinds of love. Essence love, qualities love, benefit bestowed. Here it says about three reasons for loving someone. Essence love means something that transcends reason. That's family. We are family. That's the only reason. There's no, it's irrelevant. So that's, essence love is a parent and a child. I love my child because, that's already a stupid sentence. You're a child, that's why you love them. They're smart, and if they wouldn't be smart, you wouldn't love them. Because they make a lot, and they say, whatever. It's irrelevant. It's called essence love. I love my child because they're my essence. They are an extension. They're who I am. That's who I am. They're my person. People are ready to sacrifice their life for their children. And they did. And no one should be tested. So that's an essence love. It's something that is higher than reason. That's one of the reasons that Abraham, being chesed, the source of one of the two primary emotions, chesed and gevurah, that's a Kabbalistic translation, really, of the two primary emotions. Chesed means kindness, benevolence, and love. But according to the mystics, it means being giving. The second of the two primary emotions is gvura, strength and stringency and strictness. According to the mystics, it means withholding. That's the second primary emotion. Those are two sides of the same coin. No one is completely chesed, all giving, in any relationship. Are you a stepford wife? You never say no? That's could be 95% giving and 5%. It's two sides of the same coin. Chesed and Gevura. Those were the two patriarchs. Abraham Avraham Avinu was chesed. Yitzchak Avinu never left Israel. Our patriarch, our father Isaac, was the one who at age 36, his father told him, when he said, Dad, you forgot something. We're traveling 3 days in the desert to go pray to God and get the sacrifice. We got everything but the sacrifice. And he said, you want to bet? No, he didn't say it. He said, guess what? When I was 36 years old, his father was 100. He could have easily said, oh, I don't think so, Dad. Not this lifetime. He didn't say that, you know? He said, that's where we're at. He's the second father of the Jewish people, the patriarch, Isaac. And he went. He was called Olat Tmimah. He was ready, he was there, he He let himself be tied up. He's ready to sacrifice his life. So it was it, and he became the second father of the Jewish nation. So he was Gvura. Abraham, even though he was love, he was giving. He was giving God his son Isaac. Isaac was Gvura. And the third, favorite patriarch. Why was Jacob the favorite patriarch? Abraham had a dropout son. Isaac had a dropout son. Jacob had 12 sons who became Shivteka, the tribes of God. The children of Israel, Bnei Israel, are the 12 tribes of Jacob. Mitato Shlema, beautiful expression. His bed was complete, was perfect. It means his children were. We are the descendants of the 12 children, and the Dina, and the girls, were born from Jacob. Jacob was the third of the three Sfirot of God, the third of our seven emotions. Tiferet, Chesed Gvura, Tiferet. That's the third sphere of the Sfirot. What does Tiferet mean?
Beauty.
Beauty isn't one color. Beauty isn't one note. It's a symphony, it's an orchestra, it's a rainbow. Jacob was a mixture of Chesed and Gvura. The Gvura, the withholding of his father Isaac, and the Chesed and the giving, the love of his grandfather Abraham, with an accent and a predomination of Chesed. We call that in modern English, not beauty, but balance. I need more Chesed in my life. Someone to love me back. I need to be able to say no. I need more Isaac in my life. I need more Jacob. That way my bed is clear, clean, and perfect. I need more balance in my life. Those are the three. So you see how it goes back and forth? That you can connect to, so that's there's this essence love, and then there's qualities love. Qualities love means you love someone for their qualities. Then it's called intellect love. It's called head love. The primary love of humans is emotional, not intellectual. That's the way we do it. So that's the third kind of love is benefit bestowed. Benefit bestowed, like even a teacher could be benefit bestowed. So then he differentiates between Chesed and Ahava. What's Ahava?
Love.
What's Chesed?
Knowledge.
Kindness. So here he says, light, love is the light and kindness in the vessel where it resides. Then he says something interesting. If we find this also a lot in relationships, when somebody, let's say, gets engaged to somebody else, and no one likes the guy, her friends, her family, everybody ragging on her, or even him, whatever it is, you know, doesn't matter. And you can't. They slowly cut off the friends, and then the family. Everybody knows except them that it's no good, and. Does this experience sound familiar to anyone? And so how does a person in love behave? How do they behave if they have a beloved, a significant other? They behave differently in terms of, let's say one friend after another comes over to them and says, you know what? I'm telling you this because I love you and I'm going to be honest with you. This person is no good for you. I don't know if they're good for anybody. They just, you know. And what does the person in love do? They spin it even though they hear bad things so that it's good. Oh, well, I guess, you know, he has had a bad childhood and that's a survival technique and that's a defense mechanism and whatever, I mean.
Denial.
Yeah. What happens if they don't notice bad traits and disease that the beloved has done. So again, we have 63 volumes of Mishnah. One Mishnah is called Nigaim, plagues. So there's a beautiful line there in the Mishnah of Nigaim. Kol ha-nigaim adam ro'eh chutz minigei atzmo. A person sees all plagues on everybody else except on themselves. They can pick up bad traits from a mile and a half away. But their own, they don't see that. And then mysticism says something I first found shocking. All love comes from one root, in the person. What is that inside us? Avat atzmo. Love of self. Self-love. Self-adoration. But this self-adoration has an answer. It's a mystical flip. You can never find this in the revealed Torah. To the question we originally asked. Loving someone else is already a stretch. Because it's all about me. So Adam Karov to that small. So that's a way to say love of someone else. That's takes a little work. Altruism, not to be self-absorption, self-immersed, drowning in all about me. What have you done for me lately? Okay, it's a voice from beyond. Yeah, so all love is rooted in avat atzmo, self-love. Well, the original question we asked was, in this second most popular love word in the Bible, thou shalt love your fellow as yourself. To love someone else is a stretch, to love someone else as yourself. What does that mean, really? A beautiful answer in Kabbalah. When a person looks at themselves, and if there's no way, especially if someone else brings it up, there's a beautiful line, Ehovot HaBikoret, love criticism. We know most people that really don't love criticism. I was with studying with a very prestigious super celebrity for a short period of time, until he would tell me he wanted me to marry him to his significant other who was engaged to, but she wasn't of our faith, so I told him, sorry, I can't do that. But so he never spoke to me again. But it was interesting. Every time I met him, he had two, well, there wasn't really bodyguards with him, but they were two yes men. And everywhere he went, he had this prestigious, good looking young fellows, you know, 30 something maybe late 20s, very bright, you know, dressed to them. And these were the yes men. So I told them, let's call him Chatzko. I told him, Chatzko, you can't find a Jewish girl in LA. What's it? We were at a wedding that I did, his music producer, whatever. So he says he wants me to marry him. I said, Chatzko, you can't find a Jewish girl in Los Angeles. 600,000 people there, dude. I mean, come on, get a life. Anyway, he never spoke to me again, but I thought I was being polite. So
what was his answer?
He just walked away. The yes man said, you know, forget about it, I'm out of here. Okay, bye. Anyway, all right, I'll wait. The good news is he's not home. I mean, you make movies. But this idea of love your neighbor as yourself, what does that mean? When you look at yourself and there are certain faults that are undeniable. We have a sentence in the Torah that says, I'll cope sha'im, there's three kinds of sins. Chet Peshe Navo. Peshe is the worst. What does it mean? You know exactly the time you're doing it. This is wrong, and you shouldn't do it, and you're doing it anyway. Not because you hate it, just I'm doing it. I'll cope Sha'im on all premeditated transgressions where you are conscious and aware. Tichase Ahava. Love covers it over. What kind of love covers over premeditated sins, it's impossible to say, I didn't do it, or I didn't mean it, or I did. There's no excuse for that. Self-love covers it over. When you see somebody else, and you see faults, flaws, in whatever part, you should love them like you love yourself. Just like you cover your own faults. You see, I've been doing this for a long time. People have my thing, and I could pick it up from a, well, first of all, on the job, it's not personal. But the thing is, even if you develop a relationship with somebody, that's the way you have to look at it. That's what that sentence means. Love someone else with the same kind of covering over faults like you do for yourself. So I thought that was a great flip in terms of the mystical spin. Just like your self-love covers our blatant sins, so should we cover their sins, especially since we are one unit. Okay, that's the point I'm saying. So this is, a synopsis of many pages of that encyclopedia. We have a few more. What's the idea of loving someone else? We know that the body, and there's a Yiddish expression for the body, azak flesh mit beiner, a sack of flesh and bones. So when you love someone else, that's not, you don't love the nose and the hair follicle, it's more the soul character trait, the intellect, the emotions, etc. So the physical body really, it doesn't have an animating factor. So the idea of loving someone else really means on a certain level, loving their soul. And here it says also something I thought found interesting. The way to love someone else more, or to renew love, is to meditate slowly on many details in depth of your significant other. And that way, when you have that meditation down, then love can become stronger with time, rather than not. Then he says here also something, the root of love is pleasure. You never love what you do not have pleasure from. I don't love pistachio ice cream. I like chocolate ice cream. So then he says also, love is strong, lust is stronger. Love can be to more than one person at a time. Lust is usually to one person at a time, and that's when your entire soul is drawn to that person. There's a verse in the Bible in Deuteronomy, 7:7, easy to remember. Chapter 7, verse 7. And there it says, God loved the Jewish people not because they're a majority. They were a minority. Even when the Messiah comes, they'll remain a minority. It's not because we're a lot of people, that's why God loves us. Then he said, okay, what arouses love in another person?
So
who's the smartest person that ever lived? I would say the good book in the Jewish religion, I say that.
Solomon.
Yes, Solomon the Wise. From the 24 books of the Bible, he wrote 3. One was a very prestigious book. All books are prestigious, but one's quoted by the Goyim, that's what I mean. Proverbs. What does it say in the Proverbs? Kemayim ha-panim la-panim, kein lev ha-adam la-adam. How can you rouse love in another person for you? When you look at a placid lake, and you're looking at it, you're reflecting your face, the way your face is, that's the way the lake is reflecting back your face. When you have a relationship with another person, if you, it's appropriate, show them your love. So then, the exact words are kemayim ha-panim la-panim. When you look at a lake, the way the water reflects your face, kein lev ha-adam la-adam. That's the way one heart reflects the heart of another. Then it says, what about, in the mysticism it says, what about if there was a person that you hated? That's one of the 365 prohibitions in the Bible. Lo tisna tachicha bilvarecha. Thou shalt not hate thy brother in thy heart. Now, hate. So what happens if there was somebody you hated? Is it possible for the hatred to be destroyed to the point where you love that person? According to the Kabbalah, the answer is yes.
I have a question.
Let me just finish that thought. How could it be that you change somebody from hatred to love, or you change from hating someone to loving someone? There's another emotion that does that. It destroys hate and generates love. What emotion is that?
Forgiveness.
Huh?
Forgiveness.
I couldn't hear.
Forgiveness.
Forgiveness.
Yeah, well, that's... You know, you can forgive somebody, and then they say, you know what, I accept your forgiveness, thank you very much, lose my number. Okay, I'm done here.
How could you change hate to love when the person is evil, like Hitler, like Osama bin Laden?
Okay, well, and I wasn't thinking really about, you know, prestigious historical figures. I'm talking about interpersonal relationships between people.
So it isn't always, it isn't unanimous.
Exceptions are never, you know, exceptions are exceptions. But, so the idea is, what's the emotion that we're missing that destroys hatred and generates love? I sometimes call it second guessing in terms of their personal history. But it's, here it says rachamim. What's rachamim mean?
Mercy.
Mercy. You take a look at the person, the way they behave, and then find out a little bit about their past history. You know, there was a Schwartzie's bakery originally was owned and worked in for decades by a man named Hermann Schwartz. Should have a lifting grenade, as they say, an illuminated Garden of Eden. He was a survivor of concentration camp. And he was, because of that, he was tough as nails and a hardworking man. He's a baker.
Is that the guy that owned the Jewish newspaper, the Messenger?
No. This is Hermann Schwartz, another guy. He was a baker. That's what saved him in the concentration camp. He was a baker there. And also he had what to eat. I mean, it's a starvation diet, concentration camp. But I found out that in Auschwitz, the average lifespan of a person was 90 days, 3 months. Because there were so many things you would die from. I mean, even if they didn't put you in the gas chamber. But anyway, so Hermann Schwartz survived Auschwitz, Birkenau, death camp. And he was a baker. And he came to Los Angeles, and Hermann Schwartz is a baker. It's still got three of them. It's already been sold three different times. Had nothing to do with Hermann Schwartz. But I came in when I first came to LA, and I heard, okay, he's the guy you get the baked goods from, you get the challahs for Shabbos. You have 60 people sitting at your Shabbos table. You think, okay. So I came in, and I put my hand around his shoulder. He looked at me like my hand should fall off. No one ever touched Hermann Schwartz after concentration camp. He wasn't, he's allergic to human touch. He couldn't touch him. What's klopft mir an der Pritz? He would say in a loud voice in Yiddish, what are you hitting my shoulder with? I thought I'm being nice, but I got it right away. But there's a different situation. So, what about opposites? Do opposites attract? Is that true?
Yeah.
Is that a thing?
Yes.
Yeah?
Yes.
It is
yes.
A thing, huh?
Yes. Yes.
What does it say in the Jewish? What do you think?
Yes.
Opposites
yes.
Attract.
Big
fire and water. How about that? Opposites attract. What's the best proof that opposites attract? Men and women. X and Y chromosomes. Yes. Viva la difference. There's a difference. Unisex, what a lie, what a bullshit.
So what
disgusting.
About
well, let me just, we're talking about the other 97.5%, there's only 2.5%, I have no patience for 2.5% of the population. Someone else has to take care of that. Yeah, well, how much to 97.5% of the population? For me, that's what's real, okay? You can work it out or not, but I'm into 97.5%, yeah. There is a natural attraction of opposite sexes. That must be, here it says, and that is a main love connection. Oh, man and woman, yeah, sounds right. For 97.5%. When you are, so what's the difference between Ahavak Yerish Pe'esh and Ahavak Kamayim? There's two kinds of love. Love like flames of fire and love like water. If you're next to somebody and you're there together and you have a relationship, you're exclusive, etc. So that's called water love. It's there. It's placid. It's calm. It doesn't mean you're in love, but it's avakamayim. When you're far away from each other, it's avakesh. Or even when you're far from each other physiologically, like the two genders, between men and women.
Psychologically or physiologically?
Yeah, I think all of it, all of the above.
Okay.
So another level of love is because of reason. But if there's a reason, then that kind of love tends to weaken with time, and it needs an arousal. It needs a higher level that transcends reason and does not need arousal. What kind of love transcends reason and doesn't need to be aroused? Family. Another level, the lower level, is a connection too between the lover and lovee, or the beloved, to externalities. Because externalities change every so often. So you can do it to some of the Muslims, do they trade their 40-year-old and for two 20-year-olds, I mean, by the time they get there. But, okay. And another level of love is for benefit bestowed. I can never thank you enough for saving my life, for being my teacher, my mentor, etc. What is it? Emotional love gets weakened periodically. It's good to know that. I'm doing a renewal of vows this Thursday, actually, for even I'm married 15 years, but yeah. But it's just love that is from your essence doesn't need arousal, family, because you and they are one unit. This love touches the essence of the inner heart. Now, if someone could think about that with people, so that'd be like a great thing. You see what I'm talking about, going back and forth like that? Okay, I'm done. I'll let you go. Or Q&A. Let's play Q&A for 10 minutes, and then it's time for munchies again. Yes?
Okay, slowly and clearly, before the camera, can you tell me what are the three and then the seven things that you're supposed to think about, first in English, then in Hebrew?
Right. Okay, when the commandment to put on tefillin, you're supposed to do three and seven. Coils of leather straps around your arm. What's the mystical meditation that a Kabbalist would think about while doing the coiling? Well, three and seven, or seven and three, but Ashkenazic, Sephardic. You can't do Ashkenazic, you gotta keep it together. One lane, please, at all times. So, three, let's do the mystical. It's three and seven. And that's the order, really, of things. Three intellect powers and seven emotion powers in the ten powers of your soul, which are descended from the seven spheres of God. That's what it means that God created man in God's image. The image of God in you is your soul, which is ten soul powers, three mothers and seven multiples. So when you think about wisdom, understanding, and knowledge, or intellect, so what you're thinking about is, I have a brain and I have common sense, but my common sense and my brain should tell me, if I'm looking for number three, don't find a peer, find somebody professional that has experience. Find those 7% that my strengths and my group said are effective, and give it to somebody else for more help. So that's, intellect can produce a cure for cancer. Intellect can produce a bigger bomb to kill more people. That's not a good thing. Then you have these seven emotions. You think about tying your emotions up to a power higher than yourself. Love is a primary emotion. We said the first two, right? So love for your wife is a mitzvah. Love for someone else's wife is not. So let's keep this together. So the idea of having all the seven emotions being tied up to a power higher than yourself, and how to beautify God, how to be connected, how to persevere, how to not fail the test, how to see the test, how to sensitize yourself to your intellect and your emotions. Use your intellect to understand Kabbalah better, to understand God better.
What are the seven emotions?
I'll tell him in Hebrew because there's no English really. Chagat Nehim. It's Chesed Gurat Tiferet, Netzach Hod Yesod Malchut. Those are the seven emotions. In Hebrew, they're called, or in Aramaic, Zo, Ze'er Anpin, Zion Ay, means minor, little face. When these six emotions really get together with the seventh emotion, they produce the next world. But the seventh emotion is called, the seventh emotion is called Shekhinah. It's number 10 on the scale, but Shekhinah is the feminine part, as it were, of the God being. The most important three words in Judaism are all feminines. Torah, Mitzvah, Shekhinah.
What is Shekhinah?
Shekhinah is the divine presence of God, like Shochein. The last of the 10 sefirot is Shekhinah. It also means mother, because it mothers or births the next paradigm, the next world. All the four worlds have all 10 sefirot, 10 spheres of God. And the 10th is always Shekhinah, the mother aspect of it, the feminine counterpart. The Shekhinah means the indwelling. The soul that you have, Shekhinah is called the source of souls. Knesset Yisrael, the assemblage of Israel, given to the next world. Atzilut Briya Yetzirah Asiya. Yes, Freddy.
What is the definition of Hasidim?
Well, the Hasidim, the real definition is that the people who took the Kabbalah, which was written 2,000 years ago, and they kind of dumbed it down. They made a new ism from the mysticism. They made a Hasidism. They told stories. 90% of the people 300 years ago were illiterate. They could read Hebrew, but they didn't know what it meant. They just said the prayers. The 90 people left at 13 years old. They were poor. They went to work. So 90% of people were not educated. It was the Jewish people for centuries. So they said, but they're not getting any jollies out of the religion. People are doing it, but they're depressed. Let's at least sing and dance in the synagogue. I remember as a child, a long time ago, maybe 60 years ago, 55 years ago, I went for Simchas Torah to a Yekke shul. You know what a Yekke is?
German.
A German Jewish synagogue. In Baltimore, Maryland. On the happiest day, people, when I come, they're drinking and they're dancing and they're dancing. And I went to this very, very prestigious Orthodox synagogue in Baltimore, Maryland. It was huge. And had a high ceiling. The women weren't even, on the other side of the partition. They had a balcony. Mm-hmm. And then the main floor was the men. And had 25 Torahs. The place was big. And I was 16 or whatever. You know, high school, I wasn't such a good kid. So I came with a few friends of mine. And the first thing, we even wore suits. I wasn't wearing a tie. So two guys came over to us. We were three not wearing ties. And they said, we own a tie factory. We promise to send you a dozen ties if you... You are a tie when you come to the synagogue. Okay, I get it, okay. I'm a guest there, I'm 16 years old, I get thrown out of my toes. Okay, I'll be behaving. So, they're going around for 15 minutes, it sounds like a funeral march. It's like, just about like that. No one's dancing, just walking like in a procession. I don't want to say funeral procession. Around the synagogue, big synagogue, at 25 Torahs. And some people went behind them, I think dignitaries. So I saw a young guy. So I said, can I cut in? I mean, let's take it. There's like little aisles. Give me a little Torah and we'll have some friends. We came from school. So we took it, we started. So all of a sudden, turn around, 60 guys dancing around the thing. With one Torah, like in a little offshoot aisle there. And the shamus, the one who takes care of the synagogue, they call him Herr Leiter. So Herr Leiter comes over in a very loud voice and says, will you make the synagogue a dance hall? Okay, I think we're going to go somewhere else. But once upon a time, they didn't sing in the synagogue. They certainly didn't dance in the synagogue. Herr Leiter was right. If that's where you're going to do your thing. But I was drawn more to the Hasidim who were, where they had nothing. Some of them were serious poor. I mean, in America, he's borrowing more money, but these people were serious poor, some of them, and they were really happy campers. I mean, they just, they loved their religion. You had a question? Yeah.
Yeah, I have a few questions. You said that man is made in God's image.
That's in the book, it says in Genesis?
And what image may that be?
Sorry?
What image is that?
We have some scholars in the new book, scholars, newbies. Has someone said that answer?
Soul.
Soul! Yeah. Soul, S-O-U-L.
Soul.
Soul. The soul of people, generic man, is the image of God that God created us in. And we said that the soul has 10 parts, 10 soul powers, reflecting the 10 spheroid of God, subdivided into 2, 3, and 7, 3 intellect powers, and 7 emotions. That's the image of God that's in every single living human being.
But you have to have not necessarily aspects of a godliness is within all people. So just because the soul is there...
Well, soul means a godly spark or a part of God. That's the second chapter.
But I know...
Nefesh ha-shinit b'Yisrael, yichelik elokai mimal mamash. One of the most powerful half lines in Kabbalah, that your soul is chelik, which means?
A part.
Chelik eloka, a part of God, mima'al, above, heavenly, mamash, literally. It's not a symbolic concept. There's a personal God for each individual, and the soul has your name on it.
Wow.
It's not about being eclipsed or absorbed in God. It's about your personal individual soul, and that's the way God relates to you, because he is a soul, limitless. So that means he can be a personal God at the same time keeping track of 6 billion souls. Yes, question.
If we're made in God's image, why are so many people so evil?
I guess they're making the wrong choices. Yeah. You know, it's like a rabbi says to the guy, he comes over and he says, Rabbi, you see religion doesn't work. Why do you say it? It's been around for a long time, people are reading the books and they're still rotten, terrible people. He says, come, let's go for a walk, go to the marketplace, and everybody's very dirty. And here's a guy in a booth selling soap. You see that soap doesn't work. Everybody's filthy here. Because no one uses it. That's why it doesn't work. But it so works.
Is one of the 7 emotions evilness?
No.
No.
There's 2 souls in each person. 2 voices.
Okay.
Especially people who are spiritual schizophrenics. One voice says, be kind to your neighbor, be nice, call your mother. The other one says, don't let your mother treat you like that. Hang up the... What kind of person are you? You're a schizoid. Are you nice? Are you good to your mother? Are you fighting with her? But yesterday you were a doll. Today you just fought with your mother on the phone. You made her feel terrible. Because yesterday you listened to your divine soul. Today you're listening to your natural animal soul.
Or your ego.
Well, you have evil actions. You can, if you listen to your animal soul, you have animal actions. Animal means natural, means reactionary. So it depends. You have a 2-second pause button. Whenever you get a thought, you know it came from only one of 2 sources, because you only have 2 souls. Is it your natural soul, or is it your divine holy soul? Is it your nefesh hativit, or your nefesh hachiyuit? Is it from your vital soul? Because your natural soul is not evil, it's natural. It's animal, it means reactionary. It means that it animates you. It's your animal soul. It gives you life.
One of the nicest things I heard about evil and good is that there is no evil. When there is evil, it's an absence of good. So absence of good is when you see what we call evil, but there isn't really evil.
I think this might be the time to include a very interesting parable from the Zohar. Because evil always comes up and it's a problem and sin, even it gets a Latin name. With this will sound for munchies. Theodicy is the Latin word for the problem of God and evil. Every religion has it, obviously. Or, you know, I was a campus rabbi at UCLA, you all know that. And that was a great time. And a freshman showed me a freshman logic book at UCLA. On page 8, line 7, I was out of a job. It was, well, let's say, 20 lines in the freshman logic book, and it goes, this is so, this is so. Then they had an upside down segel, you know, a triangle, like dot, dot, dot. Ergo, therefore, this is so. God is good. God is all. Evil exists, dot, dot, dot. Ergo, therefore, God doesn't.
God.
One more time. God is good. God is all. Believe in the unity of God. Evil exists, therefore God doesn't. Did you get that?
Yeah. That's retarded.
We're done. I'm done. It's over. There's no God. I mean, just he just proved me logically that there isn't.
False.
Anyway, let's wrap up the thing about theodicy, the problem of God and evil, because that's what we're dealing with right here, right now, and then it's munchy time. So the idea of what did the Zohar say? What's the parable of Zohar? You can't have a duality in the world, because that's against the most important one-liner in the Jewish religion. Hear, O Israel, God is
one.
Not a Zoroastrian two powers, evil and good. There can only be one power. Shema Yisrael, Hashem Echad. God is one, not more than one. So therefore you can't have God and evil, or God the Son, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, whatever you need, whatever, it's 930 Hindu deities, there can only be one. That first sentence negates everything but a kosher religion. Judaism says in the Jewish Bible, for a religion to be kosher, it can't be polytheistic. It has to be monotheistic. Belief in one God, believe in one God and be an ethical good person, ethical monotheism. That's what Judaism says is the kosher religion. Anything else is not. Like sacrifice, let me just finish. To sacrifice your children, that's not a good religion. To kill your children, to believe in more than one God, that's not a kosher religion. So that's the kosher religion of Shema Yisrael Hashem Echad. Are we just talking about the
Zohar?
The Zohar. What's the parable of Zohar about evil? Trying to explain evil. A king had an only son. And the only son is the heir apparent who's going to take over the kingdom. After the king dies, he's an only son. So the king wanted to train his son how to rule the country, and not by seduced by the Monica's of the world and whoever else is around, right? So the 50 shades of blue and white. So this, what did he do? He hired a loyal subject of his kingdom, namely a prostitute, and he said, you, my dear, are now doing the king's orders. She was in heaven, or hell, or whatever she was about to do. And he said, I want you, obviously not to tell my son anything, but I want you to seduce him. So in her mind, she's a loyal subject of the king. And he said, I don't want you to pull any punches or whatever they're doing there, or makeup, whatever it is. So go and give it all you got, and try to, but don't tell him. Now the king and her both are thinking the same thing. Don't do it. So she's not evil. She's in the employ of the king. She's a loyal subject, fulfilling the commandment of her monarch. At the same time, she doesn't, and she's trying, but she doesn't want him to say that. That's evil. Evil is always with quotes, never without quotes. There can only be one power. That power is a good power. What seems to be suffering and pain and terminal, etc., and the big C, there's lots of stuff written on that. It would behoove us to have a separate session about pain and suffering, if that's what you're
cool
at. But that could be good. Thanks for listening.
Thank you.
Thank you.